Welcome to the Jongets Games Impressions Vlog. Today I'll be discussing 5 new games that I was able to play recently, and I'll be going through them in alphabetical order. Now before we jump into that list, I would like to ask that if you enjoyed this video, you please click the like button for it down below, as well as the subscribe button for the channel. Also, if you would like to directly support the channel and the creation of future videos like this one, then please go to jongetsgames.com/support. There you'll find a few ways that you can really help things out, and some of them come with pretty cool bonuses like voting on a couple of the videos that I film each month. Alright, let's now jump into the games, and the first one I'll be talking about today is Key Market. Now, this is technically the second edition of the game. The first publication of this was, I think, around 2010. Now, this is a game that was out of print for a really long time, and they just had a Kickstarter that fulfilled a month or two ago, and I actually backed this one on the campaign because I have really enjoyed the last couple Key games. In particular, Key Flow and Keeper really blew me away. I love those games, so I am kind of all aboard the Key game bandwagon, so I wanted to try out Key Market. Now again, this is a second edition, so it's been around long enough and people wanted it enough to have a second edition happen, and I was able to finally get this one played just last weekend. Now technically, I've played the game twice, although I'm mostly going to be talking from one of these experiences because unfortunately I got a very small but crucial rule incorrect in that first play, so I'm going to kind of throw that one out and focus on the one four-player game that I played just last night. Now, let's briefly talk about how this game works. Now, you're going to go through 2 years, and you'll be going through 4 seasons in those years. You start off in the winter, then you go spring, summer, fall, and then you go right back into a winter and do that all over again. Now, in each one of these years, players are going to go through 3 phases. The first phase is a farming phase, where each player is going to do up to 6 actions in order, but they're all optional, and once they do up to 6, then it moves on to the next person. The first one of these is, do you want to move your farmers out on these fields? Now, these farmers are farming these fields. They can get you fruit, vegetable, you can get sheep as well as fish out there, and you can pay your coins, which is just paying straight up victory points to move your farmers around. After that, you can hire a new farmer. After that, you will produce on the fields that you are in. And interestingly enough, in this game, you are going to kind of build the fields in a different way each time you play the game. And the size of the areas of these fields does not actually matter for the production. If you have a worker in a field that's a size 4 and a worker that's in a field of size 1, they will hypothetically produce the same amount of stuff. What matters is the shape of the specific spot that worker is on. If it's a circle, then it will generally produce just 1 of a good, and if it's a square, it will generally produce 2. Now, in each season, there's a modifier. One of the circle types will produce 3 instead of 1, and one of the square types will produce 0 instead of 2. So it's something you have to pay attention to, and it's a big reason why you're going to move your workers around to try and harvest from fields that will give you a good amount of resources, and obviously move off of the fields that will give you nothing. Now, after you produce everything, you then have the option to promote some people on some guilds, and then you can upgrade your farmhouse and retire, and once you've decided to do up to all 6 of those things in order, then your turn is over, and now the next person can go through those 6 things for them. Now, once everybody has done this, you finish the farming phase for that season, and now you can move on to the market day phase. Now, here is where everybody is going to decide, essentially, what they're going to take to the market to sell. Like, in my mind, I kind of saw it as kind of a farmer's market type of situation. So you might look behind your screen and see that you have a bunch of fish and some fruit and maybe one sheep, and you're like, well, I don't really need any of those for other stuff that I'm doing, so I'm going to take all of them to sell at the market. Now you do that behind the screen, you kind of hide it in your hand. Once everybody has decided, you reveal, and you can see what everybody else is going to be selling at the market. Now in this game, there is a variable market which shows you just how much you're going to get when you sell these goods. And then at this point, you will have each person take a single action going around the table, not necessarily clockwise, the turn order can be a bit variable. And you can either sell a good, 1 to 2 of a good, or you can do a guild action. Now, selling is important because if you are able to sell early, then you can get more money, because when you sell these goods, you put one of the sold resources onto the track, and then you put the other one into the supply, and the more that are on the track, the lower the prices will be. So turn order is very important in this game, specifically for this phase of the game. Now, the other things you can do are guild actions. You're going to do exactly 1 per season, so you're going to do 8 exact guild actions throughout the game, and they let you do a variety of things, but the main thing that you're really going to focus on doing probably several times, especially early on in the game, is sponsoring one of your workers to go to a guild. Now, I've kind of glossed over that earlier on when I was talking here, but when you're playing a 4-player game, you randomly pull out 7 different guilds, and every guild has an apprentice, a craftsman, and then a master level. So when you sponsor these workers, you have to spend 2 different resources. It doesn't really matter what they are, they just have to to be different. And then they go onto that guild and you now get an ability. It's different for every one of the guilds. Perhaps you now make more of a specific type of good out there. Or maybe you sell better at the market. Maybe you buy better at the market. Or maybe you can now get discounts on paying for your people. There's a wide variety of things. Now you really want to get at least a couple of those workers out because those will give you extra bonuses. And this is really where the variability of the game comes into play, because every time you play, you're going to pick 7 out of, I think, 16, specifically for a 4-player game. With less players, you actually play with less of the guilds. Now, I mentioned earlier that in the farming phase, you could do a promote action, which just lets you move higher up on those guild boards, which usually unlocks new, better abilities and gets you more points at the end of the game. Now, at this point, I could go into a deeper dive on a lot of these specific actions, but I'm going to try to kind of fast forward to the end of this one to start talking about my impressions, because at this point, you should have a decent idea of the flow of this game. Let's come back to my main play, the one where I played the rules correctly. I guess it's worth noting, in my first play, the thing I got wrong is we sold all of our goods to the market instead of just one to the market board, so the market was flushed and nobody had enough money and it really didn't work. Spoiler alert, games play better when you play with the rules correctly in general. So it played much better when we played with the correct rules. We had a decent amount of money and we were constantly trying to make sure we were making the enough resources and also trying to make good resources to match up with what was missing out there on the market board. Now, at the end of every one of the seasons, some of the goods will flush out of the market board. And you are also, again, trying to vie for the player order. And this really comes into play at the end of the season because you have to pay 2 money for every one of your workers that's currently farming. Now, every money is a point, and every worker you cannot pay becomes fired. They essentially leave. But this is interesting because then you do the new player order for the next round, and the person with the least number of workers farming gets to go first. So it might be advantageous to fire a worker or two so you don't have to spend the victory points to keep them employed so that you then go earlier on in the next round. However, you can only hire 1 new worker each round of the game. So if you fire everyone down to a single person, it's going to take several rounds to build back up to 2, 3, and maybe 4 people again to get a bunch of resources. Now, you need these resources to get points in the game. You need to spend different types of resources to promote your people. There's also a thing where you can upgrade your farmhouse and then retire people onto there, but I'm trying not to go into too many specifics. Now, in this the correctly played play of this game, I tried to be a little bit sneaky. Like, about halfway through the game, we entered winter. And in winter, you can almost make nothing. Like, there's very few goods you can make. It depends on some of the perks you have from some of the guilds maybe let you produce some. But for me, I was not in a good position for that. So I decided to fire everyone back except for 1 person who is sitting in a village who is going to make me a luxury good. Now, that seemed smart because now we get to go first for a couple of the next rounds of the game. But the problem was that all my opponents had enough money. They just paid their people through winter, even though the people didn't really make anything. And then going into the next spring, I had like 1 or 2, I guess I hired a person, so I had 2 people, and my opponents all had 4, so they made way more resources than I did, and I really struggled to kind of catch back up there. Now, instead, my strategy for this play was I went hard on those guilds. I had somebody in 6 out of the 7 guilds at the end of the game because there was a guild that gave me discounts on sponsoring and promoting into guilds, and I got to the top spot of that guild, which gave me bonus points for having people in the guilds. So as a strategy, I would just focus on that over there, and I actually ended up coming in 2nd place. I was just about 11 points behind the 1st place player, considering I had a score of 124. 11 points is not a tiny amount, and the other person went hard on a retirement strategy. So overall, it seemed like we all enjoyed the play. I think maybe I enjoyed it the least out of the friends I had around the table when we played this game correctly. Although I enjoyed the kind of Euro-y things that we were doing, I liked the idea of trying to pick out the right guilds to try and match up with the different bonuses that I was trying to do, as I was trying to, of course, float enough money to pay for my people to keep all of this stuff going. The real problem I have with this game is the flow of it. It's very clunky. As I said earlier on, when I went through the flow of this game, like within a season, there are 3 phases. And in the first phase, you personally are doing up to 6 things. And it's kind of like a checklist. Do you want to move? Yes or no. Do you want to hire? Yes or no. Do you then you produce? Then do you want to promote? Yes or no. Do you want to upgrade your farmhouse? Yes or no. Do you want to retire? Yes or no. Done. Move on to the next person. But then you move it into the market day, and then suddenly it's like action, 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 action. And it just, I never really felt comfortable with the overall flow of the game, even in the first play, which again, we did something wrong, but it still felt clunky in both of these plays of the game because it just seem like maybe I'm too used to games that have a flow in about them. You know, like some games are worker placement games where I place a worker, you place a worker, we all place workers, and then we evaluate the workers, and then we go back into another round. Like, that's kind of a nice overall arc. A lot of other games are just play a card or do a single action, and then the next person goes, and you do that for the entire game. But to have this one be kind of like this, like, slow thing going through all these checks for myself, and then the next person, and then whizzing into the market day where suddenly it's bouncing back and forth, it seemed like in order to keep the game going, somebody had to be almost like an auction caller for the game. In fact, that's what happened in our second play. My friend Charles ended up kind of guiding people through it, like, do you want to move? No. Do you want to do this? Boom, boom, boom. Move on to the next person. And I didn't fault him for doing that, because it seemed like without that kind of marshaling action, even, you know, near the end of that second play for me, I still had to like be like, okay, which thing am I doing first? And now do I want to do this? It just felt herky-jerky overall. And yeah, I guess to me, it just seemed like kind of an old feeling game. You know, it's not new. Obviously, this is a second edition that came out 10 years before the first one. And I know that they did some small tweaks along the way between this one and the last one. But to me, it kind of seemed like maybe the game could have done with a decent wave of development to really try to smooth out some of these things. But that being said, a lot of people love this game, and so what they were looking for in a second edition of the game is just the ability to buy the game, because it was so expensive, because it was so out of print. So I don't blame them for not changing things, because that probably would have caused a bunch of people to be up in arms. But what it means for me is I just don't think this is a game for me. I wouldn't mind playing it again, but there are so many other Euro games that I would rather play that take 2 hours. In the second play, where I was experienced and the other three were new, it took pretty much exactly 2 hours. Again, with somebody kind of keeping things going, like by moving through the different phases, making sure everybody was on track. I could play a three-player game of Underwater Cities in 2 hours, and I would way rather do that. And of course, there are completely different types of games, but unfortunately for me, Key Market just did not seem to be up to snuff for really being a priority to get back to the table, so I don't think this one is probably going to get played by me again. Okay, let's now move into the second game I'll be discussing today, and that one is Maracaibo. Now, this is the newest game out by Alexander Pfister. I guess technically he also came out with Expedition to Newdale. That both of these games came out at Spiel just a few weeks ago. Now, Maracaibo is kind of like a greatest hits album for Alexander Pfister as a designer. If you are experienced with many of his other notable games like Mombasa, Great Western Trail, Royal Goods, as well as others that I'm really not thinking, but those are the main ones, then you're going to see a lot of those things in Maracaibo. Now, what's happening in this game is it's kind of set in a time of Caribbean exploration and exploitation. Honestly, it's not a great period in time overall, but what you're doing in this game is each player is in charge of essentially a mercenary ship. Now, mechanically, the way this game works is you're going to go through four overall rounds, and then the game will be over. And when it is your turn, you will have your ship out there in the Caribbean, and the Caribbean is essentially a big track, a big circular track with a couple forking paths that you can take. Now, on your turn, what you decide to do is move your ship 1 to 7 spaces forward. Now, the distance that you travel is going to matter sometimes, because there are effectively two different types of spots you can land on. One type is a small village, and the farther that you traveled to get to that village, the more village actions you then get. Now, village actions are, at the start of the game, really simple. You can spend a village action to build a card. You're going to have a hand of cards in your hand, and they all cost money in order to get played out into a tableau in front of yourself. And sometimes there's an extra requirement or maybe an extra resource like a person that you have to spend to actually play these cards out. Now, all these cards are going to give you really good bonuses. Some of them are conditional. Some of them are just straight income, like at the end of every round in the game, get a certain amount more money or a certain amount more victory points. So building these cards is super important. And this is the main reason why you're going to want to travel really fast, really far to a village to plunk down and do up to 3 village actions. Now, the other action types that you can do involve discarding all but one card from your hand. Wait, no, your whole hand. Ooh, it's been a couple, about 2 weeks since I played this one. But either way, you discard essentially your whole hand and take $2. Or lastly, you can just take a money. So those last two village actions aren't super interesting, but really you want to stop at villages to buy a couple cards. Now, the other type of spot that you can land on are towns or cities, I think. I can't remember the specific nomenclature for it. But these give you the ability to do a couple different things. Now, all of these, if you get in there soon enough, give you the ability to discard a card from your hand as a resource. Now, as I said before, the cards in your hand are multi-purpose. You can build them out into a tableau to give you a variety of benefits. But in the middle left-hand side of the cards, you also see a resource and an object that's going to be different with all of these cards. So you can discard a card and and it is now effectively tobacco, and it's gone, and it's in a discard pile. It could have maybe been a questing adventurer or something like that, but you decided to use them as a tobacco. Now, when you do that, you can actually pull an upgrade token from your ship and put it down onto the board, and on your ship, there are something like, I think, 10 or 12 upgrade spots, and after you take two upgrade tokens off of a single one of these locations, you unlock something. It could be just points or money, but it could also be new village actions that are better, like now you get a money and you get a combat point, or maybe it lets you draw up to 6 cards instead of 4. So it really lets you kind of choose a path and really unlock some really nice benefits. Now, also in these cities, you get to do a bunch of different other things, and it's going to depend from game to game what those are, because you actually kind of pick from a random pile and put these tokens out. Now, I'm not going to go into all those specifics, except for one thing, which I think is important to cover, and that is combat. Now, one of the cities, Maracaibo, out there in the Caribbean, if you land there, you can do combat, and I love the way this works in this game. Now, this might sound like you're going to fight each other, but that's not the way this works, because you are a mercenary, and you're going to fight for either the Spanish, the French, or the English, and every time you do combat, you will re-decide who you want to fight for. The way this works is you will randomly draw a tile from the top of a big stack, and you flip it over, and it will have 3 different lines on it, one for each of those colonizing nations. Now, for each one of these tracks, it will tell you how many combat points you get. So maybe you decide to go with Spain, and it says you get 3 combat points. But then down below, it says if you fought for France instead of Spain, you actually get 6 combat points, but maybe you have to spend a coin or two. Well, that's a lot more combat points, and that's important because you can spend these combat points to increase your influence with that given nation, which is going to give you a scoring multiplier at the end of the game, and or you can actually take cubes off of this nation track and put them down onto towns and then later on potentially villages, which unlocks the ability to get more points as a multiplier for how far your influence is. Now, when you pull those cubes off, you also gain influence. So what this means is you might be playing the game and you've been pushing the English because that's been working out pretty well for you. So you've been moving your influence up. So your multiplier's up to X3. And now you've unlocked enough cubes from the English track that it's like 2 points times 3 or 6 points at the end of the game. But now you draw a tile and the England line is awful, but the Spain line is great. Well, you have to decide, is it worth picking the awful England line to keep pushing England because you're already doing good there? Or maybe you switch gears and you help the Spanish out a little bit and they even give you a point or an extra couple coins for helping them out. So I love that mercenary feel. Like, you will find yourself, I've played this game twice, by the way, you will find yourself gravitating probably towards one primary nation within each play, but you are definitely going to be motivated and tempted to veer off and try to go with the others. And from my experience of playing this game twice, you should probably follow that. Just going really hard on one track is just going to make other people try to increase their influence and kind of streamline behind you based off of all the hard work that you did to get the cubes out on the board for that nation. So instead, maybe you try to streamline off of other people's work and then help another nation out and try to make that happen. In fact, in my second game, one of my opponents, Claire, pushed France really hard. In fact, she got a ton of these cubes out and maxed out the influence track and was significantly far ahead from me. Now, as I was playing, I was pushing England a decent bit, but every now and then I kind of wove in a bit of French influence. I never helped France out. I just increased my influence by doing some smaller attack actions, and there's a couple other ways that you can gain influence through some one-shot abilities. Well, I used a couple of those one-shot abilities, and when the game ended, I had matched Claire at the very end of the French track, so I had a 6x multiplier on the, like, 7 points that France gave, so it was 6 times 7, or 42 points. We both got those 42 points, and I also got, like, 15 points for England, and Claire didn't at all, because she had focused on France, and I had been able to split my myself up and kind of try and do both. Now, in her defense, this was my second play, and her first, so I think that was something I was able to better navigate, because I was more experienced with the play, but I really love the way that combat works in this game. It's a really fascinating decision. Now, circling back to moving your ship and the overall flow of the round, the overall track is, I think, about 20 or so spaces long. So if you move 7, 7, and 7, you can get to the end in effectively 3 turns. Now, that's important because the moment anyone gets to effectively the stopping point at the end of the track, then everyone else will get just one more action, and then the round is over, and all of the ships will teleport back to Havana at the start of the track. So what that means is, you don't necessarily want to go really slow in this game. If you do like a 1 move and a 2 move and a 3 move, thinking you're going to do like 10 actions in this round, you're going to be woefully disappointed when somebody else takes 4 moves and just jumps all the way around. They end the round before you actually got to some of those later villages that you were planning on. You just went there too slowly. Now, I like the fact that the game motivates you to try and go slow, because obviously more actions is good, but also go fast, because the farther you go into a village, the more actions you'll get, and the quicker you go around, the more likely there will be upgrade spots available. Some of these cities only have one or two of these spots there, so if you get in there first, you might be the only one to actually get that benefit of the upgrade, pulling the upgrade token off, as well as doing whatever action is there. Now, there's a lot of other stuff going on in this game. There's a questing track, which I don't think I'm going to even cover at this point, but I do need to talk about kind of the elephant in the room for this game, and that involves the story. Now, when I first started hearing about this game, I heard that it was going to be a, somewhat heavyweight Euro game by Alexander Pfister with a campaign, and I thought, oh man, another campaign game. I'm so sick of that. Like, I don't have time to, like, you know, organize with my friends, et cetera, et cetera. But then I started to learn more about it, and I found out that that was just a misnomer. It's not a campaign at all. Really, it should just be called Using the Story or Not. Now, when you're playing the game without the story, which you can do, you could play this game 100 times without the story, it's just going to feel like a great heavyweight Euro as you're doing all the things I've talked about. But if you decide to play with the story, it just subtly tweaks a questing mechanism, which, again, I'm not going to go into the specifics of, but when you're playing standalone, there's going to be little quests sprinkled out around. They kind of come out randomly, and they just give you a task, like discard a couple cards to do this, or, you know, discard a combat strength to do that. Now, if you play with the story instead, you have this deck of, I think, 100 cards, and you start with card number one, and it says, swap out one of the quests for this story quest. Now, what that means is, if you go there to complete that specific quest, it's a little different than the other ones, which just give you random bonuses and some extra points and whatnot. Instead, this is a story quest, which is going to give you some bonuses like money and points, but it's also going to, at the end of the round, evaluate, you're going to read it, and you're going to talk about the things that happened and, you know, the things that you did in that quest. You will then, like, flip the card over, and it will probably reveal a couple more cards, and then you have another special quest that goes out onto the board. So now in the second round out of four rounds in the game, there's a little bit of a progression with this story that's happening, which I'm trying very hard not to spoil, although honestly, I've only played the game once with the story and once without, and from what I've seen in one play of the game, the story is not exactly nuanced yet. But either way, you then have another kind of breadcrumb of the story. So now the next person might come over and do that quest, and you're incentivized to do quests anyway. They give you points, they're good, they give you some multipliers based off of some things, but it's also fun to push this along. Now, within our first play, we essentially completed the first chapter, and I put that in air quotes because it makes it sound like you're supposed to complete a chapter every single game, but that's not how this works at all. Instead, when you play this game, you just pick up from wherever you left off. Maybe you got two-thirds of the way through chapter one in your first play, so you sit down to play the game again, and you start right there, and then in the second round, maybe you start the second chapter off. We happen to finish the first chapter out, and I'm not really sure what happens after that because I haven't played it again since then, but I'm very excited to see what happens. But as a tiny, tiny little spoiler, I will say that within that first chapter, we actually added a couple new cards into our discard pile, and you go through the discard pile, you go through the deck at least once in the game that I found. So that actually increased the number of card options, and the cards we added in were relevant to the story, and they had powers and whatnot. And then we also had situations where maybe decisions had to be made, and where new cardboard tiles were put out onto the board that maybe modify a village or a town in a certain way or another, giving you extra abilities on those towns, or maybe taking away other abilities depending on the story. You know, what is happening in this moment? If a town is currently being raided in the story, as an example, then maybe you just can't go there for some reason until you go to a different town to unlock the ability to free that up. So my understanding is this is a pretty long story. I don't know how many games it's going to take to go through it, but it really seems like there's no reason to not play with this right from your first game, and you really don't have to play with everyone else, because my understanding is you can always kind of read the pretext for the most recent chapter, and it just gets you back up to speed. You know, this happened, and then this happened, and this is what you're trying to currently do. Now, again, I've only played with the story mode once at this point, but I really liked it. I think that was a really great way to just trickle in a little bit of new content as you were playing. Nothing that we saw in that first play with the story mode drastically changed anything, but it was just a nice little bit of flavor that varied things up, and I'm quite excited to see what new stuff might come in the future. Honestly, it kind of reminded me of Pandemic Legacy, even though this is not a Legacy game. A big thing I liked about Pandemic Legacy is it seemed like every time I played, there were like tiny little mini expansions being added into the game to add extra little mechanics. And in Maracaibo, it feels like you're not getting gigantic new mechanics, at least not yet, but every time you play the game, it's a little bit different, and not in a shuffle up a deck of cards and pull out random things kind of different. Now, I've talked about Maracaibo a lot at this point. There's a lot more I could say, but honestly, I should probably start wrapping this up by saying that I am intensely excited about this game after playing it twice. This is, if I had, you know, a mountain of all of the board games in the universe that are currently available to me to play in this moment, and if I did not have a YouTube channel to, like, play lots of games for variety, I would likely keep coming back to Maracaibo at this point. At least for the next play, it's absolutely the number one game I want to play. In this moment, I would love to just set the game up right now and play it with friends. And I suspect that after I finish that play, I'd probably want to play it again. It's really kind of captivated me after these two plays. And it is worth noting that it's not terribly fast, but it's not gruesomely slow either. I played a four-player game with three new players, and that play took maybe just over 2 hours, and then I played a three-player game with two new players, and I think it was approaching 2 hours, but I think there were a couple distractions in that play. Now, I really don't mind a Euro game that plays in about 2 hours, especially a heavier one with lots of stuff to think about as you're building out a big tableau, and again, there's so many other things I would love to just talk about for the next 10 minutes about, but I think I've talked about this too much. I should wrap this one up by saying, at the moment, this is potentially the best game I've played this year. It was a close contest between this one, Marco Polo 2, and The Magnificent for the best game that I played at BGGCon, but I do think that Maracaibo wins because, again, if I had all three of those games in front of me, I would want to play all of them, but I think Maracaibo would win at this moment. So I'm actively looking forward to playing this one more. I'm actively looking forward to seeing what more comes from the story that comes out of it. And I don't really care if I'm going to play with new people or not. I'll just, you know, catch them up with what happened. And I think everyone that I play with will be happy to have that little dopamine drip of new stuff. So I should stop talking about Maracaibo right now. And I should probably talk about something else, even though realistically, all I want to do is play Maracaibo at this moment. All right, let's now move on to game number three, and this one is Miyabi. Now, this is a new release from Haba Games, and it's in their not children's line. Like, it's in the same relative weight as things like Karuba and Honga and that sort of game. Now, this is a new Kiesling game, who also designed Azul and many, many, many other games. Now, I've been interested in Miyabi since I first heard about it because I like tile-laying games in general, and I especially like tile-stacking games. So what you're doing in Miyabi is each person is going to be building out their own, I believe, Japanese garden. Now, on each turn, you're going to draft a new tile from the center of the table, and you're going to put it down into your square grid. These tiles that you take might be a single space, they might be two, they also might be three in a line or in a little bit of an angle. And when you put these down onto your grid, you have a couple restrictions. The first restriction is every tile has a specific type of resource, and there are six types of these icons. I guess they're not really resources, they're like terrain stuff, like, you know, a bush or a pond or a house, that kind of thing. Now, on your board, everyone has the exact same layout. If you take a tile that shows a couple houses on it, you have to orient it so that the house icons are in the row for the houses. You must do that. You can never put a house icon in any of the other rows. Likewise, you're restricted to put the fish ponds in the fish pond row and the bush in the bush row, etc. Now, after you place a tile down, you then take a little lantern and you put it onto the column where that icon was, effectively blocking that column out for the next tile you play. So that next one you grab, you can put it down somewhere on your board. You, of course, have to match the icon up, but you cannot put the icon down into the column where you've already played in that round. Now, it's a 6x6 board, and you're going to draft six tiles, and there are exactly enough tiles in the middle of the table for each player to do six of these drafts. And after every single tile placement, you will score points for that tile. Now, if it's a single size tile, it will have one of a thing on it. If it's a two size, it'll have two fish, for instance. And if it's a three size, it might have three rocks. Now, the way you score is really simple. You just get a number of points equal to the number of items on the tile you just placed, so one, two, or three, times the level of that tile. Now, as I said before, this is a tile stacking game, and if you've built your tiles out so that you have a platform to put a new tile down on top of a couple, then that's good because if you, say, put a size two tile down onto the second layer, you get two times two or 4 points instead of the 2 points you would have got if you put it down at the bottom. Now, this obviously has a multiplier effect, and I've played this game once at this point. It was a three-player game, and as we got deeper into the game, I was able to start getting 3x, 4x, and even 5x multipliers. And if you just put a level 2 on the fourth level, then you're getting 8 points for that, which is a significant amount in the game as you're just piecing these together as you're taking all of these turns. Now, in a three-player game, you're going to play 5 rounds, and you're going to take 6 tiles per round, so that means you're taking 30 actions in this game, and it kind of feels like a micro-action style game. Obviously, that's 30 times that you're going to be scoring as you're playing the game, and there's a snake track that works pretty well, although one of the people I played with had a little bit of trouble with it and was a little concerned that maybe they went backwards on the snake track at one point or another. Now, there are a couple other things going on. Realistically, one other thing in the game is the first person to get to the fifth level for the specific types will get a token that will give them bonus points. And that's how the base game plays. It's a very simple game. Honestly, if the game was set up in front of me, I probably could have taught it with even less words than I just gave now. So that is the way that we played it. But the game does come with, I think, 4 or 5 mini little expansions, which add to the complexity of the game. Some of these expansions are really just a single scoring tile that you then put in the middle of the table, and you say, okay, you get points for everything that we talked about already, plus you are also going to get points for the number of adjacent empty fields that are there, or the number of adjacent objects that you have, or if you have exactly 7 objects in the column, and that kind of thing. And it's also worth noting, to double back, that every time you play this game, at the end of the game, players are going to get a lump sum bonus of points based off of the number of objects they have showing in each one of these rows. So that means you're trying to stack things up to get those really good multipliers while also leaving these icons showing to vie for the ample amount of points that you can get for the error majority at the end. So I played this game once at this point, and it really hit all of my buttons because, again, I like pool drafting, which is what you're doing. You're taking tiles from a diminishing pool in each one of the rounds of the game. I like tile laying, and I love it when you can stack tiles on top of each other, especially when the rules are really simple. Like, a lot of tile laying games have special little caveats like you can stack on top of other ones, but only if you're covering 2 tiles, etc., etc. But in this game, it just says there just can't be anything lingering off. You can just put it down as long as there's a decent base for it that covers up all of the spots. You can put that there, and it gives this game a really nice puzzly vibe to it. I was able to teach this one to 3 people total, me and 2 other people. We taught it and played a full game in about 45 minutes, maybe 50 minutes. So this is a relatively quick game. Again, we did not play with any of the extra scoring modules, which are definitely going to increase the amount of complexity of things you're thinking. And honestly, I would like to play with 1 or 2 of those going into the future, but I kind of worry that they might push the game towards a little bit of analysis paralysis, which might slow it down into a gaming experience that I don't necessarily like. So yeah, at this point, I think this is a game I am looking forward to cracking open several more times, especially when maybe we're waiting for more people to show up, or maybe a game has 30 minutes before it's over, to see if we can squeeze in a quick game of Miyabi, because I really enjoy the little decisions that you're making throughout the game, and it's got a really nice dopamine effect of just like getting points every single turn, and like you put a thing down and you're like, 3 times 3, that's 9 points, and it just feels good going up that track. So overall, like I said, it's just a feel-good type of game that I enjoyed. I think my opponents thought it was fine. One person was a little bit take it or leave it with it, and the other person, I think, liked it a little bit more. But I very much liked it. But again, this is super my wheelhouse. At this point, we have reached game number 4, which is Paris New Eden. Now, I played this one once at Board Game Geek Con, and this is a funky little dice drafting game. So the way it works is you're going to play through a number of rounds in the game, I think it was 4, and at the start of each round, you're going to roll a bunch of dice and put them down onto different action spots in the middle of the board. The number of dice in each spot is going to vary based off of the player count and based off of the action type. And then what you do is you go through a couple different phases in the turn. The first phase involves each player in order taking a single one of these dice from one of the locations on the board. You take the die and you put it down onto your own player board, and then you don't do anything with the die itself. The face that shows up on the die does not matter at this point, but what you do get to do is activate the action of the area you just pulled that die from. So it kind of has an inverse worker placement vibe to it, as the dice dry up from these action spots that you might want to activate. Those spots might give you access to effective dice that you can use later on in the round. They might give you food, which will help you feed some of your people to give you extra points. You might be able to modify some mid-round, mid-game scoring, and you also might get some hidden secret objectives that you're going to work towards with these actions. Now, once everybody has drafted, I believe it was all of the dice from the middle of the board, you then shift into the next phase of the round, which is a little bit funky, because in this game, there are, I believe, 5 different types of dice showing or pip sides on these d6s. One side is wild, and there are essentially 5 different types of buildings at the bottom of the board. Now, what you do is you start on the left-hand side with the tinkerer buildings, and you ask everybody in player order, how many tinkerers are you going to put forward towards trying to build a tinkerer building, which is, I believe, the yellow. Now, if you look down in front of you, if you have a die that shows the yellow tinkerer icon on it, then you are essentially forced to use it because you're going to lose all of your dice at the end of the round. So there's just no reason to keep them around. But then there are also these extra tokens that are matched up that you could optionally use. Some of them are wild and some of them aren't, but you can reserve those from round to round. Now, I might say that I have three tinkerers and the next person decides they're going to put forward two and maybe save a tinkerer token for another round. You go around the table, and then once you have had everybody call this out, the person who has the most tinkerers will now get to take one of the face-up tinkerer buildings, and you put it face-up in front of you, and some of those give you ongoing benefits and extra ways that you can score different things as you are getting all of these different buildings. So you're going to go through the tinkerers, and then the ninja-y people, and the priest-y people, and the healers, and there's a wide variety, but we just went, you know, purple, green, yellow, red, etc. as we went through these. So realistically, the dice that you're drafting in the first phase of the game are all about vying for the buildings that you want in the second phase of each given round. You're also, of course, trying to take dice from the location that gives you the action that you actually want to do. So you're kind of double thinking every time you're drafting these dice. So that's essentially the game. I mean, there's definitely a little bit more to it, but that's the main beat for the game. And this was one of the first games I played at BGGCon, and I played this with three other people. I taught them the game, and there was a lot of distractions. I will say, this is Board Game Geek Con. It was right at the beginning. Everybody is super excited. Lots of people are coming in at every point in time, and I think, unfortunately, our four-player game took probably about 2.5 hours, but it had to be at least 45 minutes in the middle there of just distractions, of people coming in, going. So I really can't fault the game for that. Now, one thing I can say is that I quite enjoyed the decisions I was making as I was drafting to try and go based off of what other people had. But I can also say that some of the other people I was playing with, it just didn't seem to really lock in for them. Like, I don't think anybody hated the game. I feel like at the end of the game, most of the people felt kind of take it or leave it. Like, yeah, it was kind of interesting, but it was a little bit weird. And I don't know, like, it's a strange thing as you're playing the game because you're presented with these decisions, which are not straightforward, but they're so not straightforward that you can find yourself thinking, like, what is actually good for me to do, and have a little bit of trouble figuring that out. Like, you can kind of think and double think yourself in a lot of different ways. I think that's because this game is doing a couple new things here where you have the inverse worker placement going on, and the inverse workers you're taking feed into another round that's going to be kind of like an open bidding thing that you're all vying for, and there's a tiebreaker token, and there's all this other stuff going on. So I think at the end of the day, where I stand with the game is I think it's pretty neat. Like, I feel like it pushed me into a mind state that I was not familiar with, which is a little bit unusual for board gaming. It seems like these days, a lot of board games, you sit down and you're like, it's a worker placement game that also has variable turn order, and it's the type of worker placement where you bump the workers out. Okay, let's play. But this one, while it did feel like, you know, a bit of dice drafting and a bit of bidding, the way they came together created a decision space that I was not used to. And again, I don't think some of the people I played with really enjoyed that decision space that they found themselves in. I kind of feel a little bit more take it than leave it, but I did not go out of my way to play the game again. And I think at this point, I would have no problem playing it again, but I don't have access to a copy, and I don't really think that's a problem. So I don't think I'm going to be trying to go out and get a copy of this one. And if it was on the shelf at like a board game cafe, I'm not sure how excited I would be to pull it down and teach it to other people, considering how mismatched it kind of felt with some of the other people that I played with. But again, it was the first game of the convention. There were a lot of distractions, and the fact that it felt a little bit fresh in its decision space probably kind of hurt it overall because of those distractions. So take this with a relatively decent-sized grain of salt, but that's essentially my thoughts right now on Paris New Eden. Okay, it's now time for the fifth and final game I'll be talking about today, and that one is The Crew, or The Crew, when this comes out in English. Now, this is a new release from Cosmos Games, and it's a game that I had heard literally nothing about when I went into Board Game Geek Con, but that is a five-day convention, and as the days went on, I heard more and more whispers about it, I heard more and more just buzz going on, and by the time we got to Saturday, way late in the evening, I finally got a chance to play this one. Now, my friend T had played this one already, and they wanted to teach it to myself and two of my other friends, so we sat down to play this, and this is, on its outset, a really simple trick-taking game, like hearts or spades or, you know, that kind of game. So the way the game works is you're going to deal out a deck of cards. It has four suits. Each suit goes 1 to 9, and then there's a special trump suit, which is always trump, and it has a 1, a 2, a 3, and a 4. Now, the way this game works is the person who leads a trick is going to put a card out, and then the next person has to play a card of the same suit, so that matches up with a lot of trick-taking games. But the catch to this game is that it's fully cooperative. So that is definitely a difference from most trick-taking games. And the way this game works is in the very first round that you're going to play, you're going to start off with Mission 1, which is really simple. You're just going to pull a goal card out, which is going to match one of the main suit cards in the game. Perhaps you'll pull out a pink 4. Now that's going to randomly be put in front of one of the players, and then everybody will collectively win together the moment that specific player wins a trick with that specific card. So that's the mission for this round, and in fact, you don't play through the whole hand. The moment that happens, you can say the mission is done and move on. Now, that's a little bit tricky because you're all effectively in space and you're not supposed to be able to communicate with each other. Now, fortunately, there is one way that you can communicate, and that involves taking one card from your hand and you put it face up on the table so that everyone can see it. You then take a dummy card and you put that back into your hand so you can actually essentially play the card that's in front of you. You're essentially just showing a card, but it's still in your hand. Now, after you do that, you can put a token down on the card to indicate if this is the only card of that suit you have, if it's the highest of that suit you have, or the lowest. And obviously, this is a bunch of information that you can give out. In the first round, the person who has the card that needs to be won should probably just communicate that so that people can play around it. And for our experience, that is what we did, and we easily finished the first mission. So, hooray, we shuffled everything back up and we went into the second mission. Well, now there are two of these goal cards. One goes over there, one goes over there. Maybe this is a, you know, pink 2 and that one's a green 5. Well, now we win once that person wins a trick with that exact card and that person wins a trick with that exact card. So it's the same thing, but a little bit harder. Now you can move into the third mission where things get tricky because you're going to give out two of these missions, but there is an order. Now this person has to win this specific card before that wins a trick with that specific card. Now for us, our situation was we dealt out a yellow 2 and a yellow 4, and the yellow 2 had to be won before the yellow 4, which was honestly a bit tricky. I don't exactly remember how we pulled it off, but we did, and we, you know, felt really good about it. Like, it was just a fun experience trying to make this happen as you're not communicating, you're just flicking your eyes back and forth between the players, communicating maybe one card, but that's all the communication you can do. And funnily enough, the game comes with this little token. It's got a black side, and on the other side, it has a little penciled out illustration of the International Space Station. Now, the function of this token is it's a distress token. So if you feel like you're in distress, you take the token, you flip it over, and now everyone knows you're in distress. And that's it. That's the only function of this token in the game. It doesn't help you out in any way, but I guess it just feeds into the overall theme of the game. And I guess it communicates something. Like, if you're the person who's supposed to win that mission and you throw the distress thing, everybody knows that this is going to be a harder mission than you might think. Now, moving on, there are even more complicated mission styles. There was one that involved us trying to decide who had the strongest and weakest hand based off of almost no information, and then one person had to win zero tricks, so you had to go through the entire hand and have that person win none, and there are a whole bunch more. We only played through like four hands, and then it hit 1 a.m. and the hot games room closed, so we lost access to the game. And we all loved the game. Like, we had a super fun time. In general, I'm more of a climbing game style person than a trick-taking style game person. I've played Teach You well over 100 times, for instance, and I've only played Bridge once and, you know, Spades a couple times. But that being said, I just really loved the mentality of how this game worked. I loved how simple the rules were, so you can teach this very quick, especially if people are familiar with other trick-taking style games. And it was just a really cool decision space to be in, trying to play a trick-taking game, but not to win for yourself or not to win a certain number of tricks for yourself like a lot of trick-taking games are. It's all about setting things up so that specific mission can happen. And as they get more and more complicated, the stress mounts. And then if you win, it's great. And if you lose, well, it's not that big of a deal. It was just, you know, one overall hand and you can jump right back in. So this one was super fun overall. I think all of us are looking forward to playing it more. I think it's likely all of us are going to source a copy. We looked into trying to get one from Amazon.de, but it looks like it's actually out of stock there. So I think the hype for this game is definitely getting real. Cosmos might not have realized that they have a bit of a gem on their hands right here. So it's not going to be stocked until about January. I've already heard that they're pushing out an English copy of this one as fast as they can at some point in early 2020. So I do think at some point I'm going to have a copy of this. In general, I'm not super crazy about cooperative style games, but this one just had a really cool feel to it overall. And again, this is one I definitely hope to be able to play more in the future. All right, we've now reached the end of this impressions vlog. I've talked about 5 games today, and I think I have about 18 more games that I'll be talking about in a set of 4 more impressions vlogs that I'll be recording soon and trickling out over the course of December. So feel free to look out for those in the future, and I hope you've enjoyed learning about some of these new games right here today, and I think that's going to bring me to the end. As always, I'd like to thank everyone who's been supporting this channel, including all of these producer-level Patreon backers. If you too would like to directly support the channel and the creation of videos like this one, then please go to johngetsgames.com/support to see a variety of ways with which you could do that. Also, if you enjoyed this video, please click the like button down below as well as the subscribe button for the channel. Thanks for watching!